There's been rumors about buying a castle, and those rumors went worldwide. We didn't get enough money to buy the castle, but we did get enough money to run the game 3 times more in November. Here's a little sneak peek about the game.
Student with extraordinary abilities at a magical school, full with bumbling professors, troublesome ghosts, a little intrigue, and magical creatures in the forest.
So, that was a little sneak peek. I just took one minute. There's like a 18-minute documentary, which is really good, which we got made by an actual film crew. So one of the really great things about the game is that we did a lot of documentation about the game, how it went. And we had a lot of nice pictures because it has nice visuals, so it's easy to make nice pictures and nice film. Just to give some few examples, this was inside the library. And here we have the night's hall where everybody was sitting having their dinner. So it's, and we have a little ritual in the forest. But there was a lot of co-creation. There was a lot of previewing characters. There was a lot of media attention, a lot of copyright infringement, a lot of magic, a lot of everything, and a lot of exclamation marks and all over Facebook. But I'm only going to be talking about game design because we don't have that much time. So to go right through it, there was a term coined, I think, after Monster Celestor, which was a game a bit before ours. But we sort of worked on it, this blockbuster module or formula, where we sort of packed the game with a lot of stuff to do. So we fill in, we like brute force in a lot of plots and a lot of happenings and events and places to go. And in this game, we had like classes and teachers and school, like gears and houses. And there was so much stuff that you could do. You could go to the forest, you could go to the dungeon, you could go through the secret corridors. There was always something to do. So you were never bored, at least not if, and unless you wanted to, because there was always somewhere you could go and get stuff to do. And that's sort of one of the main design things, a philosophy for our game. And most of our games, that we just fill in stuff until people have enough. You don't have to involve yourself in all of it. So there's like lots of stories. Many traditional games, there's like one main plot line, one big storyline. In our game, there was not a one storyline. There was hundreds of storylines. Each player had 10, and they could choose which one to navigate through. They didn't have to use them all. Then also very importantly, because we had a lot of new players coming to the game and we wanted to sort of go into the mainstream and really reach out to people all around the world, we tried to make the design as intuitive as possible, which means that it's easier to understand, it feels natural. And one of the ways we did that is in our spellcasting system, which I will, for those who want to, I will show it to you in the lunch. Then I will walk you through how you use spells at College of Wizardry, which was a very, very simple design. You didn't have to remember like 100 spells. It was just like some hand signs, like 3 or 4, and then you knew what to do and what should happen. And always the receiver always determined the outcome. So if you didn't understand what people try to do when they cast a spell on you, you could just turn into a chicken and like, because it's not important what you do. It's not, there's not like a fixed point that if I say fireball, then you have to turn into fire. If I say fireball, you can choose. Maybe you become a roasted chicken. And I mean, you could really choose whatever you wanted to do. And that's why it was really intuitive, it was really simple, it was easy to understand. At least that's what we tried to achieve. Then we designed for groups, and a lot of groups, so everyone was in at least 3 or 4 groups with people that they somehow had stuff to do with. They had their, as I told, they had years, so there was 3 years that people could go to. The junior year, sophomore year, senior year. And also there was 5 different paths, so study paths, and there were classes, and yeah, the houses, and there was so much, so many groups that you could be in, and that you could easily get to relate to other people. We had no written relations for the game, at least in the first run of it. But it's still, people was, it was very easy to people because you were like in a house with someone, like in Harry Potter. And you know, okay, so I can speak to everyone in my house. Like in the summer school here, we know that we can talk to each other. We might not be able to talk to the breakdancers out there because they're not part of our group, but we can talk to each other because we are a group. And that's where this group design is very, very powerful because it makes a lot of stuff much easier for you as a designer to have groups and think in groups all the time. Yes. To sort of support this group structure, we did a lot of things with the social media, and also because we had players coming from all around the world. So instead of having like a workshop where everybody had to meet up a month before the game, we did everything on the internet, because if we told the Americans, you can only go to our game if you meet up in Copenhagen at the 1st of May, 2 months before the game, and then we have like a weekend's workshop, and it'll be like, no. And then there'll be no American LARPers going, and that would be really a big shame. But because we did most of the pre-game, most of the pre-work and workshopping on the internet, in Facebook groups, and on this amazing co-created thing called Chohabuk, which was one of our players designed a Facebook. He programmed his own kind of Facebook, which was, he called Chohabuk, which was like, here you were gonna play your character in this Facebook-like designed thing. And yeah, it was really, really amazing how much people did. And we really tried to enforce that and support it. And we were also, to support this social media thing, we were always available. Me and especially Klaus, but also our Polish friends who are also doing the game. We tried to be available for questioning 24/7. So we had like phones ready to answer and all that stuff. So every time people were motivated to write something on the Facebook group or somewhere, we were always ready to support it and say, yeah, that's a great idea, do more of it. And that sort of created an environment where people were always feeling like, oh, the organizers actually care about what we're doing and bringing to the game. And I think that's a big lesson that we often underestimate, how much we can get the players to contribute if we just tell them they're doing a great job. You just need to go into the Facebook group, and if somebody puts up a picture of the costume, if you just give it a like, or tell them that's a cool costume, they're like, oh, now I know that I feel so much better now because the organizers have told me my costume is great. And their experience is gonna be better. They're gonna tell the other players that they should make their costumes in good time, because then they get praisal and more people make the costumes. And yeah, it gets a lot for very little, very little effort from our side. And the last design point that I'm going to talk about is designing for rerunnability. Right from the get-go, we decided that we at least want to make it so we could make it. We want to design the game so we could run it many times. What we did, or the main thing that we did to enforce this, was that we made a design document where we basically wrote everything about the game. So we wrote like, how is interaction going, how is the houses going to be, how is the sorting going to be, how is the NPCs, how is the all the design aspects we have in the design document. It's like a 60, now maybe it's an 80 page document now. And we've given this out to the players. So everybody could see it. It's online and it's evolving. And they come and they read the document and they say, oh, but what about this? You need this. And we're like, yeah, okay, we need it. And then we write more. So we always evolve and learn more about our design and use co-creation to extend and make this even better. And you can go there in November, you can go there in April, and you might even be able to go there in November again next year. It's a little bit expensive because it's in a castle, but if you have the opportunity, I think it's worth going there. Thank you very much.